a good time. Put a smile on your face, yeah. KBKM and Elation Radio. Even brighten your day and help you through the night. Bring you good music. KBKM and Elation Radio. And here's your host.
Hello, my name is Glenda Johnson, better known as G. Johnson. When I'm not busy, I like tuning in to Elations Radio on Saturday nights with Apostle Irvin A. Whitlow, Jr., where the topic of discussion is making marriage meaningful. It appeals to the saved and the unsaved. It's for couples who are married, couples who are thinking about marriage, and for those who are divorced yet considering remarriage. Now, this discussion, making marriage meaningful, is the most explicit, authentic relationship talk live here on Elations Radio. So save the date and time on your calendar. We look forward to hearing and seeing from you at 10 o'clock p.m. Eastern Standard Time and 9 o'clock p.m. Central. So tune in to the broadcast and be blessed. Amen.
His presence, press in. Welcome to Making Marriage Meaningful. This is your host, Apostle Irvin Whitlow. Well, God bless you, God bless you, God bless you. It is once again that we are joining together for Making Marriage Meaningful. And I want you to know that I thank God for the opportunity to come into your homes, into your vehicles, or wherever you may be listening to this podcast from. I want to put this disclaimer out there. I do not claim to be a relationship expert, but I certainly have gone through enough things in life through relationships and marriages. Yes, I did say marriages, meaning I've been married more than once, and I've learned some things. I believe it was God's way to help me to help people. So that's one thing I want you to understand. That don't want you to say, well, he told me this and this didn't work. No, I'm just going to give you some things that should, if you apply it based upon your situation, it will help you. I believe in Jesus' name. Now, listen, I want to put this other disclaimer out there that this conversation, it is really real. We don't come up with fake, fictitious stuff. It is raw, meaning it's not sugar-coated. It is always relevant. I guarantee you what we share with you, you will be able to identify with. And I need you to understand that I don't do this by myself. I have a panel of men and women of God, some who are preachers and some who just are in fellowship with the church of God, some who are married, some who are widowed, some who are divorced, some who are single and thinking about marriage, some who are considering remarriage, all of that. We deal with just about everything. And so we're going to just have a discussion, and we're hoping that you will let somebody know that Making Marriage Meaningful is on the air with your host, Apostle Irvin Whitlow. Let me see who's here tonight. Let's see who's joining us tonight. First of all, I believe that my producer is here. If it wasn't for her, the show would not be on at any point anyway. So Dr. Kimmy Robinson, come on and say hello to us this evening.
Hello. This is the day that the Lord has made, and I'm going to rejoice. Amen.
Amen. So happy to hear your voice. Thank God for you. We appreciate you in Jesus'
name.
Amen. 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 Let me see who else is here. I'm going to see if the great bishop-elect, Ernest E. Richard Jr., is with us tonight. Are you here, sir? Okay. So if he's not unmuted, then he must not be here, because normally he would say something. Well, let me see about the other big brother. I'm talking about Apostle Vincent L. Smith. Are you here tonight, sir? All right, that's two. All right. Well, let me see. I believe that Reverend Billy Gabriel is here tonight. Are you here, sir?
Yes, I am. Thank you. Yes, I am.
Amen. God bless you. Thank God for you. Amen. Well, let me see. He wasn't here last week with his wife. I'm talking about Brother and Lady Otis Gabriel. Are you all here tonight? Okay. They're not here. I don't hear their voice anyway. And let me see. Apostle Felicia Fleiss, are you here tonight?
Wow. Oh, I forgot. I thought we were going to say something real quick. I'm here.
Well, thank God for you and those of you who are here. Amen. There may be someone else who's on the line who may have called in. Would you like to identify yourself and join in the conversation tonight? Just give me a heads up. I'd like to know. Going once. Going
Brother
twice.
Chuck.
Who's that there?
Brother Chuck.
Oh, Brother Chuck, how you doing there, Brother Chuck? God bless you. Welcome back. Thank you for joining us again tonight. Amen. Amen. Anyone else? Anyone else? I don't want to miss anybody. Anyone else? All right. Well, we say thank God for each and every one of you. We appreciate you in Jesus' name. All right. Apostle Fleiss, would you please, for kindness, to lead us in a word of prayer tonight? I'll read the scripture, and then we'll set the stage for our conversation tonight. Amen.
Amen. Precious Father, we truly thank you now, God, for all things. Father, we thank you, Lord God, for waking us up this morning, oh God, with the activities of our limbs, Father. Father, we thank you that we don't take life for granted anymore. God, I ask right now in the matchless name of Jesus that, Lord God, tonight's podcast, oh God, will go smooth, oh God. Let the people, oh God, know that are joining in, that will come back and watch it on YouTube, that this thing, oh God, that we call making marriage meaningful is meaningful to us, oh God. Those who desire, oh God, to be married again, those who desire, oh God, to make their marriage work after they've called it quits, those, oh God, that desire, oh God, to give it just one more try. Father, I ask, oh God, that you be glorified, oh God, in the matchless name of Jesus. We pray. Amen. Amen.
Hello?
I can hear you. Like everybody with fire.
Okay. I'm here. I am. I'm back. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. I forgot that I was on mute. Amen. All right. So listen, Matthew 19, beginning with verse 1, it says, "And it came to pass that when Jesus had finished these sayings, he departed from Galilee and came into the coast of Judea beyond Jordan, and great multitude followed him, and he healed them there. The Pharisees also came unto him, tempting him, saying unto him, Is it lawful for a man to put away his wife for every cause? And he answered and said unto him, Have ye not read that he which made them at the beginning made them male and female, and said, For this cause shall a man leave father and mother, shall cleave to his wife, and the twain shall be one flesh. Wherefore, they are no more twain, but one flesh. What therefore God hath joined together, let no man put asunder." Amen. The word of God for the people of God. And we've been talking about conflict resolution. What I want to do tonight is I want to talk about fighting fair. In conflict resolution, I want to talk about fighting fair. Here's where I'm at in my mind. Again, we have seen that many people have divorced in this day and time because of what they call irreconcilable differences, meaning it's an unwillingness to come to a happy medium where they see eye to eye. The problem is the reason they don't see eye to eye is because one of the two or both of them do not fight fair. What do I mean they do not fight fair? One of the worst things I believe that a person can do in a marriage is throw up past history, throw up failures, throw up, if you will, and this out of spite, shortages. I'm going to deal with that in a minute. But I discovered that people, when they fight, they don't fight fair. And it has caused certain folk in marriage to say, you know what, I'm not going to tolerate this. Therefore, the solution is divorce. Now, we have to admit there is no perfect marriage. There is no perfect relationship. Every relationship will have its tests, will have its trials, will have its challenges. But the key is learning how to fight fair. And that is something that many people don't know. Here, let me give you an example. I once dealt with a scenario where the wife at the time and I had a disagreement, and because of the disagreement, even though we had a vehicle together, her threat would be, I'm going to tell the police you stole the vehicle, especially because I was dealing with something that had me, if you will, on probation. And if you get into any kind of run-ins with the law during probation, it becomes a very bad scenario at the end of the day. So the threat of, I'll call the police on you, when it's our vehicle, became an unfair fight because I knew what my predicament was. She knew what my predicament was, but she would use that, if you will, to try to get the upper hand. Now, in a sense, it's manipulation, it's control, it's not right. But the most important thing is, it's not fighting fair. I want to hear what you think about that when we talk about fighting fair. Dr. Kimmy, what is your mindset when we talk about fighting fair in marriage?
When I think about fighting fair, we must first listen to one another, address the issue. If we can't come up with a great resolution, the wife, if she trusts her man and she believes in the Bible, allow him to make that final decision. But it must be done, you know, in love, because I really believe that when we do submit to our husband, and if he loves us as Christ loves the church, he will always put my best interest with his together. So I believe that we should listen to each other. Don't talk, over talk each other. Be careful on the words you say, proactively listen. And, you know, just have a, because you want to disagree. I mean, we're not alike. We're not totally alike. So when you are in a marriage, it's good to listen to one another. But I still believe that the male, if there's no mutual understanding, that the male, that the husband has the final say. That is my belief. Amen.
Okay, amen. Hey, Brother Chuck, why don't you tell me, what do you think about when you think of fighting fair in marriage?
I don't think that the term fighting should be applied in any form to marriage. So whether you're fighting fair or fighting in love, I don't think the word fighting should be involved in any relationship that you expect to maintain and sustain.
Okay, okay. Let me ask you, Apostle Flight, when you think of, because I know that you have had some scenarios in life where you have dealt with something, I'm sure, on this wise. So talk to me about what you think about this fighting fair in marriage.
Listen, I like what both Brother Chuck and Sister Kimmy said, because at the end of the day, and I'll use me as an example, I don't always say the right thing. And sometimes I can come off a little razzle-dazzle, as you would say. I do. I'm very headstrong. But at the end of the day, my husband has the final say whether I agree with him or not. You know, so disagreements, yes. But fighting, no, because when you use the word fight, it's more of a physical thing. And, again, we're going to argue. We're going to have some disagreements. But, again, I'm like Brother Chuck. When you come out fighting, see, I don't like that word at all, because I get a flashback and you mess around and pull up your hand. I'm thinking you about to hit me and I'm going to tag you first. So, you know, And then you hit him below the belt. Now that, if you really want to get on my bad side, do that. Hit below the belt. That's some things that you just, That's a tit for tat thing. That's being vindictive, and I do not tolerate that at all. I just don't. I don't do that. So that's my thing on that one.
Well, I appreciate that, but you tapped into something, because you know you said doing the tit for tat, and I respect what you said, Brother Chuck, that fighting should never be used in any relationship. And I understand that. But we know when disagreements come, for a lot of people, rules go out the door. But this tit for tat, that's almost the equivalent of, well, you killed my cat, I'm coming for your dog. That's what that reminds me of. And it makes me feel some kind of way to think that there are people who actually operate like that. Yeah, well, shoot, you did it to me, so I might as well do it to you. Like, really? Where does this mindset come from to do such things? Because this is what we see in this day. This is what we see in this time. And I don't believe it's right, but it is something that is definitely taking place. So the tit for tat. Let's talk about that. Come on, Reverend Billy, talk to me about when you think about tit for tat in a relationship when there's conflict of interest and they're at odds with each other. Talk to me about tit for tat.
Tit for tat. But first, I would like to address, I'm going to do both, about the question initially about fighting fair. And on my side, I can see that the word fighting fair, when you say it, I consider that in a sense of an analogy or a metaphor. When you talk about fighting fair and the relationship, especially when it comes to, I liken to the lack of communication, a lack of paying attention to each other. That is more like a conflict of yay and nay of one another. Not so necessarily physical fighting, but a conflict, a misunderstanding, area of not respecting one another, and the act of likely not needing one another. And that's where I'm saying that, because we have these conflicts, and we speak in terms of the irreconcilable differences. There's two sides that must be resolved, and that, in effect, it comes into, quote, a fight, but not so much a fisticuff, but right versus listening versus not listening, understanding not understanding, giving attention to one another. Now, as far as a tit for tat, no. Bring it up. You did this, that's why I did that. You did this, I said this, and that's why you made me do this. That there has to come an area of a mutual communication, a mutual understanding, where you can just sit down and talk to one another to resolve these issues, things that causing that the differences. And one man might have an idea of sending flowers to the. That's another subject altogether. But that is an area. I use that word fighting as an analogy or a metaphor of and resolution solving. And that's what I'm saying. And when you're not fighting fair, you're not listening to one another, and you are doing that tit for tat. Bringing up old issues and new issues, that means you're not moving anywhere. Both of you are being stubborn, and it's not fair to do that because one of you have to listen. Well, you both have to listen and then resolve it once the issues have been put forward. I'm dropping the mic on that here.
Amen. Amen. You know, there are some things that we have to really look at. You know, because people, listen, let's be truthful. Part of the reason that there's a lot, there are conflicts of interest is because we just, as a people, we see things differently. We see things, she sees it this way, he sees it that way, and so now they think they have to prove that they're right. For instance, here's a good scenario. Cell phones having passwords. She wants his password to his phone, and he won't give it. So she feels he's hiding something because she gives her password to him. So now we have a conflict of interest. So now we're having words. Well, you don't love me because you won't give me your password. Well, I don't think I should have to give you my password because you should trust me. So now we have this thing going on, and they don't know how to communicate about it. You know, you talked about that, Reverend Billy, about being able to communicate, but they don't know how to talk about it because they feel like they're being violated because they believe they should have their rights. In their marriage, they should have their right to keep certain things to themselves. So let's even approach that in marriage. marriage, does a husband have a right to keep things from his wife? Does a wife have a right to keep things from the husband? Somebody answer that for me.
Put me in, coach.
Well, come on and talk to me then and tell me. I want to know.
Okay. So I look at it like this now. Okay. Oh, Lord, help me, Jesus. With iPhone, we have to have a password. If not, your phone can easily be hacked and too easy to be, what's the word I'm looking for? Come on, Felicia. Easily to be not hacked, and it's another word I'm looking for. Anyway, be that as it may. Now, because, and I'm speaking those things that be not as though they are, because my husband will be in ministry, for certain things, yes, I would need his password for health issues, but I have to trust him. I don't mind about giving out my password, but he may have some where he's counseling somebody, and that information is confidential. Yeah, but if okay, I'm gonna piss some people off when I say this. It's the lack of trust, the insecurity, all that. Some men feel that it's okay for their wife to go on their phone. I got some stuff on my phone that I'm going to blackmail some people with. I'm just saying. but I mean, it's all a limit. I don't mind about my husband going through my phone, looking at it. I don't mind. Because if you really think about it now, let's be 100, all of us on here adults. There's certain phones you can still hide stuff on. See? You just have to know how to use technology, but you also have to learn how to trust your mate. So, you know, if trust is an issue, you might need to reevaluate the situation. You know, if you can't trust him or you can't trust her, that need to be to the forefront before y'all move forward, because if you don't have trust, communication, that's with the brother and sister. If you don't have it, it's a problem. Somebody need to help me. I think my niece is on here. I need for her to help me on this. Somebody else jump in. I'm ready to tag.
Come on, talk to us, Dr. Kimmy. Come on, Dr.
Yes,
Kimmy, talk to us. What do you think about
that?
That?
Because I really believe that it should be fair game. But if I have, I'm gonna be honest, if I have to go through your phone, that means that I don't trust you. So I don't really do all of that stuff. I mean, I can see if I need to do that if maybe someone got into, you know, emergency or something happened to has happened to him. But other than that, I shouldn't have to go through that. I really believe that if there's trust, I have to go through his phone, he should have to go through my purse. I mean, that's not what I look for, because, you know, sometimes you can tell whether or not you can trust someone right away, because God will give you that discernment. So I really believe that when you are in a marriage, I should have to go through your things like that. I'm sorry. That's immaturity for me. I yield the mic.
Amen. Amen. So you shouldn't have to. But you have those who feel that if they don't know the password, you're holding something. And so because you're holding something, then you're not being faithful. You're not being truthful or something, you know, and it should not be that way. But it caused this big old huge fight. And so before you know it, what she's talking about, well, you know what? I don't want to be with you because I don't believe I can trust you because you hiding stuff from me or you keeping something from me. But could it be because maybe her last relationship made her feel insecure, and then that her feelings were not validated? Maybe could that have been the problem?
Well, they should have took care of that before they got married. I mean, if you're married, I want to first address your insecurities and the things that is required for us to have a mature adult marriage, because if that's important to you, that should have been discussed beforehand. If it's not important to you, well, don't bring it up. But for me, I don't need that. I mean, I really believe when you're going
put me back in.
I really believe.
All right, well, come on. Talk to me.
Kimmy, that's what's up. Yeah.
We got to have that up front, because if I can't trust you up front and you make me feel, you know, some men, I'm going to say this, and Kimmy, I don't know if you're going to agree with this. Some men do simple stuff to make women feel like, what are you hiding? And then on the reverse side of that, some women do the same thing that a man will say, what are you hiding? I don't sleep with my phone. I don't do that. I don't have to sleep with my phone. And I have to. My iPad is hooked up to my phone. So, I mean, there is ways around a person getting in your phone. I mean, let's be honest. But if the conversation is there, I agree with my sister with that. If the conversation is on the table, you can pretty much look at somebody and tell whether or not they just lying, per se. But if I got to do all of that, it's not even worth it. It's just not worth it.
But listen to me. These are things that are causing people to have serious disagreements in their marriage. And so what they're doing, they're fighting because they feel like they're not being heard or they're not being respected. They feel like they're being violated. Come on, these are real things. And there are people who are willing to end it all. Right now, there is some woman who is upset with her husband because he refuses to give her the password to the phone, right? Wait a minute. Hey, let's go even further than that. You have those who are upset if they're not able to share a joint account. And they will get totally heated mad, right, and say, well, you're trying to keep stuff from me. You've got all these kind of things that to some people may be insignificant, but there are some folk who are stuck there. And if you will, they are fighting for it because they're like, this is, well, we're married now. And because when you get married, you give up the me for us and for we, but you still got those who talk about me and mine. So these are still some issues. These are still some issues, and people are sitting here, I don't get this. Come on, talk to me, Brother Chuck. What are you thinking? What's on your mind? Talk to me.
Well, I think an open form of communication, whether it's pleasant or not, is basically critical. So a lot of times I think people read into matters which are not the same as they may appear, because in my career, I've had to engage with women on several occasions where it, from the surface, it would have appeared that, you know, there was something other going on other than the business that we were talking about. So I've always expressed to my wife that when she sees me out or she hears about me being out, ask me about it and I will reveal to her and tell her about it. As a matter of fact, I have had occasions where people have seen me and thought that there was something going on that was not going on and made the call and told, you know, my wife, I saw your husband, blah, 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 blah. Well, I explained to her and told her, who it was. So I think that open communications in situations like that becomes extremely valuable. I dropped the mic.
Amen. Amen. So communication, again, becomes very essential. But when you have a person who they don't know how to communicate, when you have a person who doesn't know how to, because, you know, some people just don't know how to talk. Let's just be truthful. Some folks don't know how to talk. All they know how to do is fuss. All they know how to do is complain. All they know how to do is murmur. But they don't know how to really have a conversation to make things better. So how do we help people on that wise? If we can't help them to talk and whatnot and get to, how do we really help them? How do we get them past that? Because, you know, they're fighting over stuff that might have an easy solution. How do we help them? Anybody?
This is Chuck speaking. There is a period that we go through called courtship. And that was a song one time, I think, and the title was "Take Time to Get to Know Her." or take time to get to know him. So I think it's during that particular period that we discover the characteristics of the people that we have a deep interest in.
And I respect that. We got to take time to get to know a person. But, you know, people can put up a front for so long because people have done it for so long. Oh, I don't have to let them know the true me, the real me. I can hide. I can keep this front up for so long. Because let's tell the truth, that's something that they do. Come on, Reverend Billy, talk to me. What are you thinking right here?
I think the original question was, should we keep secrets? Should we keep secrets from one another? Now, on this day and time, especially now, the men and the women have. There are some things, of course, you cannot share all the time. Even though we are married, we are also our own personal individual. Now, there as far as the home. We some of us have jobs, for example, and there are some jobs that we have that you cannot share with anybody. That's a little cliche. That some of the things they say, I have a job that's so secure that if I tell somebody, I will have to shoot you. But I'm saying there are some things on our phones or some of the things that we have that if shared with the family. Might cause some peril or some trouble if that other second person known that maybe don't have the clearance, don't have the need to know. I'm going militarily now. There are some things that we just don't have the need to know. Now, as far as the relationship is concerned, that might cause him or her to arouse some type of suspicion that can only be caused by their behavior of lack of attention, lack of, going back to that word again, communication skills, and lack of respecting one another. There should be some means, should not be in a way that I can act suspiciously that would cause him to say something's going on. That is often displayed by the way we communicate with each other, how we treat with one another, and react all together. But there are some things that really don't need to be shared. I hope I'm saying this right because there are. But if how can I put this? If I'm acting in such a way that I can say that my wife Mary, or whatever name might be, that make her think about my behavior changes, and my things of that nature, to cause her to want to go through my phone to search from some evidence of him cheating, or her cheating, and all too often, if that other than the serious matter, the serious job thing, if you're searching for something, you have to be careful. What is your reaction if you find what you're looking for? If there's a, then what? What is the actual purpose of searching? Is it helpful? Is it destructive? If you're trying to find something negative or positive? That's where I think the disruption come in. I hope I'm saying this right. When you create an atmosphere of impropriety, of cheating, that's the word, cheating or something that you really should not be doing, because you want to be putting the trackers on the phone, sneaking and calling, trying to find out stuff on. That's what I'm talking about. I just don't think it's a requirement to tell everything this year.
Okay. So we're looking at this. We're looking at this. And again, we're talking about, this is conflict resolution, but we're talking about fighting fair. Let's see if we can come up with some solutions that will help alleviate some of the things that are causing people to think that a divorce is the answer. Let's be truthful. Divorce should never be a first result.
Absolutely.
Divorce should be an absolute extreme last result, meaning you should have exhausted all kind of other efforts in order to avoid that. So let me ask this question. When people don't know how to fight fair, if you will, they don't know how to have a healthy disagreement, because there is a such thing as a healthy disagreement. So if they don't know how to have a healthy disagreement, does it make sense to go to counseling, or is counseling a waste of time? Anybody talk to me on that.
Okay. There have times that is, your last sentence has been expressed many times, especially from men. That I just have to, I'm just talking from personal experience. I know men who outrightly and vehemently say, I don't need no counseling. They can't tell me something that I already know myself. And which means they are buffering against advice from spiritual or professional counselors that would help remedy or to resolve the problem. And in that case, it becomes bullheaded. That's my expression in regards of his obstinance of trying to resolve this problem. I agree that, and before the divorce, I not to be repeating what you said, it just seemed that the two of you, if you are interested in each other and resolving the marriage, you can either sit down and talk openly, honestly, and addressing the things that's displeasing, the things that I'm saying or not saying, the things that I'm not doing, that I should not be doing on both sides, and we find the negatives or the things that's troubling. We should have the reason to accept that, and we can get that erased. Okay, this is one. I agree. You're right. We don't need to do this or this thing. I think that's problem solving. If you just take time, if you're interested in each other, and you take time to just write down these things that is bothering you, that's hampering us, that we can kick out of the way. That comes right back again. Word. Communication. Finish.
Okay. Amen. If I'm not mistaken, I believe that Bishop Elect has joined us. Are you there?
Yes, I am. Yes, amen. I am. Yes,
amen.
I am. How are you, sir?
All is well. What do you want to say?
Well, I'm listening, and I'm trying to catch up, and I'm hearing a double echo for some strange reason. I'm not sure why that is. But I'm trying to catch the gist of what the question is.
I mean, it sounds like you're asking, is there a reason why a man or a woman would want to go through their spouse's phone?
Is that close?
I'm not certain.
I'm trying to understand what the question is,
and again, I'm hearing a double echo. I don't know where it's coming from.
Okay.
I'll call right back.
Let's see if that'll erase it.
That was an elder.
Please check your.
Okay. That's wild. Okay. Hopefully this will make it a little better. Amen. Amen. Okay,
I'm so almost
by that
because
I'm not used to that.
Can you
locate that?
You may have to mute all phones and then open them one at a time.
Okay.
Okay.
Is this echo?
Yes, it is.
Okay, I don't know what's going on with that.
I'm on
right now.
Let's everybody go on mute and then come off gradually.
It might be have to do that. Maybe you have to do that. Because right now
do.
I don't hear it.
Right now I don't hear it either.
But the question was about when we're dealing with fighting fair in marriage because of conflict resolution, dealing with fighting fair, you know, would it help to go to counseling? And that's where Reverend Billy was talking, and he was saying how there are men who's like, I'm not going to expose myself to this because I don't need to talk to anybody. So we just really wanted to know, because what we're trying to do is we're trying to help solve this conflict. We're trying to do this conflict resolution and helping people to fight fair. You know, people hit below the belt. People say the most unusual things when they're mad, and Apostle Flight talked about doing the tits of tat, you know, and Brother Chuck was like, there should be no fighting. There should be never be the term fighting in any relationship. So we're trying to figure out some resolutions, some things that will help people who are battling things like this.
Well, okay, well, I can offer this. The first thing that has to happen, and it's a must, you have to recognize that there is a problem. You can't resolve anything if you're not willing to admit that there is a problem. And there are some men and some women who will give you the I'm all right, it's the rest of the world that needs help approach. You know, and we have another word for that that we hear a lot of in this day and age. It's called narcissist. A narcissist is the type of individual who will create an issue but will develop a way whereby they could come out smelling like a rose as if they've done nothing wrong. And when you have narcissistic individuals in a relationship, whether it's marriage or just plain old boyfriend and girlfriend, you've already got a problem. A narcissist has a hard time seeing what the problem is, and they're not going to admit that they have a problem. So I would say counseling is helpful only at the point that you recognize that there actually is a problem. I hope I've answered your question.
I think you have, and I appreciate that, you know, again, because the objective is we want to help somebody who is currently dealing with this thing we call conflict resolution, who is trying to figure out how to handle, because there are some people who really love their mate. There is a man who loves his wife, as in the world they say, I love her to death, but yet they will mistreat each other, they will talk down to each other, they will abuse each other. Right? And then they say, well, you know what? It's just best to get a divorce. Divorce is not the first solution. It is not we're going to end this thing because I don't believe anybody got married just to get divorced.
Well,
I believe
can
people
I offer
get married
this?
Because they really want to be married for the long haul. But if you don't know how to grow together, if you don't know how to be a support to each other in the growth process, then you're liable to do damage to each other. Does that make any sense?
It makes a lot of sense. And see, what you're saying there is basically, you know, there's no other way to really describe that type of relationship. It's an unhealthy setting in anything. And see, God forbid if there are any kids involved. Because now the situation becomes double toxic. Because one, their first inclination, if divorce is their first thought, then my question to them is, why did you get married? And if you say because you love him, I'm going to slap you. I'm going to Will Smith slap you if you say it. I promise you. And the reason I'm going to do that is because if you love them, you don't understand what love is. I mean, love is a giver, and love is not a taker. And if an individual, after the first year, and usually between the first 5 years of marriage, year one to year five is where these silly thoughts that you just mentioned come to the surface. And what we're seeing here is because they realized that while they were walking around lovey-dovey, going barefoot in the park, googly-eyed and head over heels in love, sit on the telephone and do nothing but breathe on each other, now reality sets in. They're stuck, in a sense, with each other. They're in each other's face every day. You wake up in the morning and there he is or there she is. You're in the kitchen and, you know, when you first got started, she had a Coke bottle shape, and only after 3 months she's developing a milk bottle shape. And, you know, you're starting to dislike things about this individual because, you know, based on appearances and based on your personal preferences, you've thrown out the window all that supposed inner good that you saw in them or claimed you saw in them. Somehow, all that's gone out the window. All that has dissipated. What happened? Well, first and foremost, you came off of Cloud 81. You came off of Fantasy Island. You stopped acting like, you know, the dream has died, so to speak. Can I say it like that? And now you got to face reality.
Okay.
You're not looking at what you thought. You're not looking at that dream machine that you're not looking at that dream the way you thought it was when you first got started.
Well, okay.
But during the course
talk,
of my I hope I understood that you're married somebody even though you don't love them. I think that was one of the things that really attracts the fact that you want to marry. That's because you do at that time get to love them. But at the process of time, of course, you get used to one another, and then we become very comfortable and complacent with one another, but still are not reserving time for one another. You're taking each other for granted that everything's okay. But I personally, as a result of the position that I'm in, if I had known then what I know now, I didn't act upon it, that you need to have a continuance of a display of affection. You have to have a continuance of sharing things with one another. That regardless of if they're becoming on both sides, the male also gains weight, that's a their physical attributes might change, but you're still the person. You're still the person you marry, and you are still the person she married. It works both sides. And no matter what I say tonight, it still comes right back to communication.
I want to say this, and you're not wrong in what you're saying, Brother Billy, Reverend Billy, I'm sorry. You are not wrong in what you are saying. What's happening is communication is the key to set up the entire process, and I thoroughly agree with that. But, you know, it's a funny thing. You can call that woman, I'm going to go from a man's perspective, you can call that woman every day, twice a day, and through her all day long about everything under the sun. How is it that after you said I do, and maybe after 30 days of marriage, the conversation has all but dissipated? You know, I'm a little baffled with that. What happened that now suddenly you discover you have nothing in common, nothing to talk about? I mean, what happened? I'm just asking that question. What happened? Because, I mean, the truth of the matter is either you were, and I don't want to use the word love wrong, but I've got to use it this way so you know. You were in lust, and you called it love, okay? You were infatuated, and you thought it was enough to say I do. And so you said I do, and you found out that you didn't really want to. So your I do was actually a, I want to. In other words, I want the milk, but I ain't ready to buy the cow. I'm not calling you ladies cows. Don't get me wrong. You know, but the bottom line is, and that's the mentality of some men. Some men are still got they players club card out. You know, they meet a good looking woman and they figure they're going to play the field, tell her everything they think she wants to hear and say everything under the sun that they think might tickle that woman's ears and cause her to turn toward him. And then when that woman presses him about marriage, the next thing you know, just to shut her up, he's hollering, yeah, 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 yeah. All right, so now you got to quiet for a few minutes until the day of the wedding. OMG. Now what do? I told this woman I'd marry her. Here's the day. Now what? So you go through it, and you go through it with a smile on your face, and you figure it's going to be all right. Now here's the last thing I'm going to throw in here because I know I'm going to – I try not to be long-winded in my answers. The reality that I'm trying to get us to all see is in conflict resolution – in solving the problem, whatever it is, no matter how major or minor that problem might be, there has to be a recognition that there is actually a problem. And if you can't recognize there's a problem, what are we resolving? Just out of curiosity, what are we resolving? Seriously, what are we resolving? I'm just asking.
Well, the question is, do people really want to resolve things?
Apostle. That's a good question.
Do people really want to resolve things? You know, first of all, let's go this route. It is a definite fact that people are not getting married for love. People get married because they need a bill paid. People get married because they don't want to live in, if you will, shacking up. At least those who have a conscience, those who are part of some local assembly, those who might have some parents who may be in, somewhat in ministry or something. So some people are just obligated, if you will, to get married because what? They don't want to feel like they're doing the wrong thing. So that's some people. So you got those who get married because they need a bill paid, those who get married because they don't want to look a certain way, and then you got those who get married because they might need a green card. They get married because they don't want to get deported. Oh boy, I probably shouldn't have said that part.
I'm glad you said that.
I mean, you know, there are different reasons. People make all these reasons for why they get married, but let's be truthful. Many of them are not getting married because they've heard from the Lord. Hear from the Lord, it doesn't take a whole lot to say, you know what, this is the Lord's doing. This is what we need to do. When it's God, you just go ahead. You know, you're like, okay, this is what God is saying, and we're going to go with that. Point blank, period. I met a couple. They're getting married sometime this year, right?
Uh-huh.
And the woman told the man, said, you know, we got a date set, but you ain't even asked me to marry you.
And wow.
The man told the woman, said, is there a date set? She said, yes. Man told the woman, said, are the rings on layaway? Woman said, yes. The man said, well, you just show up that day. That's all you do.
Oh, Lord. You know what? Can I say this, too? People actually, and I'm saying this, and I'm being very transparent when I say this. The second time I got married, I waited almost 8 years before I married again after my first wife passed away. Okay. The problem with that was basically I married for sex. I didn't marry for love. I married so I could safely and legally have sex, which was stupid. You know, I took and twisted this woman's life to a certain degree so I could have some satisfaction. So Mr. Happy, we'll call him that. So Mr. Happy can have a little joy. Did I think about that woman's feelings? Did I think about that woman's demeanor? Did I even consider the fact that that woman might have been sick? Well, she actually wasn't, so it's not like anything got lost. But still, I didn't take any of that into consideration. None of it. You know what I'm saying? And I'm saying that today because there might be somebody out there that's thinking about getting married for that very same reason. I'm going to simply say don't do it. And I'm sorry, ladies, with all the respect I have within me, I'm going to say it this way. If you've seen one WAP, you've seen another. You read between the lines.
You know you shouldn't have written that.
I said WAP. Yes, right. But I got to say, when you see one,
you've seen them all.
When you've been in one, you've been in them all because they all have the same lubricant. And all,
I don't know about that part. No, I'm going to disagree. I'm going to disagree.
I'm not going to measure. Listen.
While one may be wet, the other one is dry. So you got a WAP and you got a DAP. I'm gonna tell the truth. Okay. Anyway, so Lord Jesus help us tonight.
Do something with it, Jesus.
If it ain't wet, it's dry. That burns. That burns. So I'm gonna leave that right there. Anyway, listen. At the
Blackbird
end of the day,
saying bring the women back in and let them talk. Well, listen. I only said that.
Oh my. I'm just saying. We have to look at all these things. At the end of the day, we have to look at all these things. And if we don't, we're going to miss the things that God wants us to get. We're going to miss the things that will help us to do better at the end of the day. And
well,
that's what we don't want to do. We don't want to miss the things that God wants us to have to help us to get to the place he's calling us to, especially in marriage. Too many marriages are breaking up unnecessarily. Too many people are going to divorce court unnecessarily. And it is my prayer that we can help someone change their mind and say, you know what, we might be facing something, but we're going to stick it out. We're going to get past this. We're going to get through this, but we ain't going to give up on this. I believe that love is good. I believe that love is real. I believe that love is genuine, and I believe that people are looking for love, but unfortunately, some people are just looking for it in the wrong place. And I believe that God is wanting us to help folk to, if you will, help folk to reassess where they went wrong and to make things right. That's just where my heart is. If for some reason, if somehow God blesses me to ever get married again, I promise it's going to be the best one of my life. After all that I've been through, I promise it'll be the best one of my life. Why? Because I'm going to do things a whole lot differently. Because I'll tell you now, for me, I'm not going to go to bed, right, letting her sleep in one room and I'm sleeping in another. Oh, no. Listen, the madder she gets at me, the more I'm going to tap that back. I'm just saying, I'm talking about me. The more she upset with me, the more I'm gonna kiss on her. I'm gonna overwhelm her with love. So she gonna be like a Solomon's woman. I'm sick of love. He just loves me. I don't know what to do. I'm so sick of love. Cause what? I'm not gonna let this one go down the drain no more. I ain't gonna let it happen. Listen, we have the ability to make a difference.
I'm talking
to men. We have the ability to make the difference. I'm just trying to help somebody. Why? Because conflict resolution is important. Right. Fighting fair is right. See, because when I speak of fighting fair, I'm speaking of fighting for it. I'm not fighting to lose it. I'm fighting to keep it. I'm fighting to make sure she no baby. You ain't got to worry about going nowhere else. You ain't got to worry about nobody else in your life. No, this, I'm it. I am it. I am the sugar honey iced tea. Point blank, period.
Just say that, why don't you?
Well, you know, I'm being real. Anybody, come on, talk to me. What are y'all thinking? We having this conversation. What's on your mind? I want to hear from y'all. Talk to me.
Brother Blackbird said, get the women back in. They seem to have dissipated.
Yeah. Hey, man, get the women back in. I can hear this.
Yeah, I think
women.
I think Apostle Flife lost her signal or something, so she hasn't been able to get back in. Come on, Dr. Kimmy, you want to say something to us? Come on.
Muted.
I just want to say I prefer, and I just want to say that it's not the reason why someone gets married, because that's, you know, as we get older, you know, we aren't able to really deliver like we used to. So you need more. And then, you know, the beauty on the outside will eventually start fading away. So you need substance. You need something that's going to hold you on to the end. And that's why God says to make sure that, you know, this is your rib, you know. She's bone of your bone, flesh of your flesh. And we must continue on seeking the herb strength in our relationship with each other, especially if you want it to be meaningful. So I really believe that if you don't marry for love, I mean for lust or sex, you marry for love and then build on that, because as you learn each other, you grow. And as you have one disagreement and you are able to solve that, it builds your relationship up even further. But I really believe that when I do get married again, it would be the best. So I concur what was said. Don't marry for sex.
Talk to me, Brother Chuck. Talk to me.
Well, I concur with the sister that just spoke, and I'll say amen, 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 because time is filled with swift transitions, and some of them transfer us to a different position. So one of the things that we have to be careful
I ain't messing with you tonight, Chuck.
I'm just trying to make a plane preach.
Oh, Lord.
So,
my brother turned around and said, some of transfer to different positions.
The mind is willing, but the body is silly.
Bless you.
So I agree with the sister, and I agree wholeheartedly. That's why I wanted to hear from them, because, you know, we can get this down at the barbershop, but we don't have many sisters sitting in the barber chair when we're talking about what we can do and what we have done. So I just need to hear from the sisters.
They starting to take over the barbershops now.
We do have Apostle Smith on. His phone is interesting, so I'm going to unmute him. But he is here. But it's his phone.
Who's that?
I miss my friend. I want to hear from him. So I'm going to unmute him, so it may be a little echoey.
Muted.
Apostle Smith?
Do I need to call him?
Yeah, because that's the phone.
All right, Apostle Smith, I'll call you right now.
Amen.
Oh, well, but yes, amen. I concur.
All right. Well, we're gonna wrap up tonight's show early. There are just so many things that are going on. Just got back in town from preaching and then had to do another meeting just before this. And, you know, there are so many things. What we're looking for is ways to solve the issues that marriages are facing. And I believe that this should be one way to offer some solutions, some suggestions that will be beneficial. And I believe that is possible if we seek to make use of the information we have. It becomes possible. I believe that fully and thoroughly and immensely. But it's up to us to make use of it some kind of way. Listen, we want to thank you for joining Making Marriage Meaningful. Want you to join us next Saturday night at 10 p.m. Eastern, 9 Central, as we will embark upon some other things to help make marriage meaningful. Thanks to all of you who joined. We pray that you have an amazing night and that you get yourself some good rest and have a great week as we are about to enter Passion Week. We pray that you will experience the presence of Christ as he entered into town and came to deliver us from our sins. In the meantime, your marriage will be meaningless until your mate becomes meaningful. So husbands, wives, if you're tapping on each other sometime tonight before you wake up, learn to roll over. And if you're single and you get tapped on, you better go get a cold shower. Keep it clean. Keep it holy. Yes, sir.
Y'all can hear me.
Before you go, I got Apostle Smith finally on the line.
Well, thank God for him. Amen. We thank God that he made it in. Amen. But we're shutting the show down. So we need him to show up next week, and he go talk next week with the help of the Lord.
Yeah,
he
but
do
when
some, Apostle Smith.
I was talking, but you couldn't hear me.
No, we couldn't hear. What did you say?
I don't know what was going on with the line, but I was talking and y'all couldn't hear me.
I'll just say quick.
I heard a lot about people get together for sex, but you were asking for a solution. Let me tell you something. If people are not going to get divorced, they got to sit down first with each other and come up with truth. That's the first thing.
Absolutely.
Come up with truth. Somebody needs to say, first of all, well, I married you on false pretense. If that's the problem, I married you on false pretense. I married you looking at your body, having wonderful conversation with you. We went bowling together. We went to the pool hall together. We had wonderful activity time, but they don't really know and can't really say that you are the one I'm supposed to be married to. I just married you off of stuff. I didn't marry you because I really know that you are my mate. I married you because we were having a good time. And see, so that's what has to happen if you're going to have some kind of solution to the problem that's going on. There has to be a truth talk and sit down and talk about why we where we are now. Opposed, before we got married, you looked like you were the best choice in the world. If that's not happening, then there was something off even before you said, I do. And I heard Brother Rich talking. I'm going to tell you the truth. When I got married to one young lady, she was driving all the way from where she lived. Coming up here, taking my kids to the mall. They're going to the movies. And she was sad out of her mouth. I didn't come up here for you. I came just to hang out with the girls and take them places and have a good time. But after we got married and came back home, she didn't have 2 cents to say to the girls from the day we walked in the door until the marriage is over. I don't understand that kind of stuff. So I understand exactly what he was talking about, And it goes in different ways. It was the girls for me. Sometimes it's the person themselves. Sometimes it's different things that you're doing. But there has to be a truth talk. And, you know, you got to come to a head of what happened, where we're headed, what we need to do, if there's going to be some counseling. And then if there is going to be some counseling, are we getting an older married couple? Or are we going to the pastor and first lady? Or are we going to a counseling, a same counseling agency? A decision has to be made. Thank you so much, sir.
Apostle Smith, I like that. Gotta have a truth talk. A truth talk. Here's what I want you to do. On next week, while I will be here, I want you to talk to us some more, and let's indulge, or let's endeavor to get into this thing called truth talk. I want you to bring that to me next week and spearhead that for me, and we will go from there. In Jesus' name. I pray that everybody has an amazing week, that the Lord continues to bless and keep you. All right? You be encouraged, be blessed. But remember, your marriage will be meaningless until your mate becomes meaningful. Dr. Kimmy, I need you to get that track tonight. Y'all have an amazing night. We say shalom, shalom. Go with God, and he will go with you.